see it.
We interrupt our program to bring you this important message.
You're listening to Carousel Sniper Victim, a Dead Glass Design production, with your host, Sean Jeffrey.
The year is 1942, and Singapore has fallen to the Japanese, and with it, the vital air route that delivers top-secret airmail and VIPs between Britain and Australia. Qantas has proposed to re-establish the air route, with Catalina flying boats travelling an almost impossible 32 hours non-stop from Perth to Galle in the south of Ceylon. The flights were top secret and flew under the cover of darkness to avoid capture by the Japanese. Overloaded with fuel and hunted by the enemy, these flights would break the air blockade of Australia and help win the war.
If you're walking along the banks of the Swan River, here in my hometown of Perth, Western Australia, when you pass through the suburb of Nedlands, you'll come across a little plaque on the riverbank talking about the story of the double sunrise and how it took place right where that plaque is located. But to understand the story of the double sunrise, you have to sort of understand the precursor events, such as the fall of Singapore to Japan. To understand the fall of Singapore, you have to also understand that, you know, they still called it the Far East, and there was the Southeast Asian and the Southwest Pacific theatres of war, and it gets convoluted, but we'll do a brief overview. The fall of Singapore was fought in the Southeast Asian theatre of the Pacific War when the Empire of Japan invaded the British stronghold of Singapore, nicknamed the Gibraltar of the East. Prior to the invasion, Singapore was a major British military base and economic trading port in Southeast Asia, and was the key to British imperial interwar defence planning for Southeast Asia and the Southwest Pacific, which was then known as the Far East. The fighting in Singapore lasted for about a week from the 8th to the 15th of February 1942, after the 2 months during which Japanese forces advanced down the Malayan Peninsula. The campaign, including the final battle, was a decisive Japanese victory, resulting in the Japanese capture of Singapore and the largest British surrender in its history. About 80,000 British, Indian, Australian, and Malayan troops in Singapore became prisoners of war, joining 50,000 taken by the Japanese in the earlier Malayan campaign. British Prime Minister Winston Churchill called it the worst disaster in British military history. By 1942, the Japanese were now established in every landfall between Australia and Singapore.
Welcome to the shores of Britain some women and children who have known the hell of Malaya. They were lucky enough to get away before Singapore fell to the Japanese. They have left their husbands behind. They have come through the horrors of dive bombing and other forms of air attack in a land which had practically no air defense. But we may hope that out of their suffering may come good, because Britain is awake again.
Australia was now effectively cut off from England via air. What was desperately needed was to re-establish this link, and fast. It was at this point that Qantas founder Hudson Fysh proposed to the government that a fleet of Catalina flying boats be used to link Australia to Britain via Ceylon, present-day Sri Lanka. A flight of more than 5,600 kilometres through enemy-controlled skies. Now, for every Australian, the name Qantas is synonymous with air travel today. The name Qantas is as Australian as Vegemite. But for a bit of context, and, you know, maybe for some of our overseas listeners, it's important to touch on the history of this iconic Australian symbol of air travel, the famous flying kangaroo. In November of 1920, World War I veterans Paul McGuinness and Hudson Fysh envisioned an air service connecting Australia to the wider world. They had recently completed the first overland motor survey of northern Australia by Model T Ford, quite an achievement in itself. Soon after, Queensland and Northern Territory Aerial Services Limited, Qantas, was registered as a business on the 16th of November, 1920. Founding chairman Fergus McMaster wrote that Qantas was inspired by the spirit of Anzac. The first Qantas air routes provided vital connections to the people of Western Queensland, who responded with enthusiasm by purchasing shares and travelling by air. The founders' vision was always set on the horizon. They were pioneering a new form of travel, not just an airline. The NT in Qantas represented their plan to fly overseas via Darwin as the main aerial port of entry at that time. From joyriding and charter work based at Longreach in Western Queensland, a route network quickly developed. The vision for overseas expansion was achieved in 1935, with services between Brisbane and Singapore taking 3.5 days using DH-86 aircraft. From 1938, Empire flying boats linked Sydney and Singapore, now introducing full cabin service and modern comfort. Despite having several of its aircraft transferred to the Royal Australian Air Force, RAF, Qantas continued to operate air services to Singapore and within Australia after war was declared in 1939. Qantas crews ferried 19 Catalina flying boats from the United States to Australia in the opening days of 1941. The first of these flights was just the second east-to-west aerial crossing of the Pacific Ocean. It was a little over a year later that the Singapore services ceased in February of 1942. As Japanese forces now occupied most of Southeast Asia. Qantas flying boats were now evacuating servicemen and civilians from the Dutch East Indies to Australia. In early 1942, Qantas suffered the loss of two of its Empire flying boats shot down by Japanese aircraft. The Qantas hangar and flying boat servicing facilities were also destroyed in the first Japanese air raid on Darwin on the 19th of February the same year. Like it or not, Qantas Airlines were now very much in the fight. Australia was cut off from Britain via air. Someone better come up with a solution, and fast.
At the time of the first raid, which was about 3 minutes to ten, the first one on the 19th. I remember it was a Thursday, well, and we'd already dug slit trenches and sandbags, but About 3 minutes to ten, the wave of about 138 zeros come over, and then the next thing they just pounded us, and the first 500-pound drop was on the outskirts of Larrakia Barracks ground, which was only about 500 yards from us, and I took a photo of three of our fellas in the first big hole that was left there, you know. Now that was the first one, and in between that, I was a silly 19-year-old, I was about the only one who had a camera. I started walking down towards the wharf above the top, and I took photographs where they bombed the middle of the wharf, Stokes' wharf, and then I gradually come back, not knowing that they were going to hit us again at 3 minutes to 12 the same day, same morning, you know. And so I was a bit lucky, actually. Well, we just scrambled around. There wasn't much that we could do because we had no equipment, nothing to, only our old 303s, and they weren't much damn good. Each raid got smaller and smaller, of course, after the first two big ones on the first morning. Then one of those raids, of course, I was in the old Carlin Hospital, and I was just coming out of the anaesthetic, and I had an operation for appendicitis, and all they did was put a spare mattress over me and left my head sticking out, and they then were dropping daisy cutters, and daisy cutters were little bombs that were filled with metal and splattered metal everywhere, you know, and smashed windows, but I'm still here. So we sort of had an idea of something was going, but never knew they were going to bomb us, you know. But because that was the same armada that bombed Pearl Harbor and bombed us, and that's history now, of course. No, we had 53 raids in the time that we left there. We left in April 43. It's a long time ago now, but I can remember it well. You don't forget when you're young. There's only about 1,600 troops altogether, you know. They could have just walked over us, but they didn't want it. We were a bit lucky that way. I'm the only one that's been going every year since 92 for the 50th anniversary. And we had the 60th down at the wharf, and because they're all fading over. I was the youngest in my unit, and I don't think there's any of them left out of my 66 now.
Although accommodation for the Qantas personnel was scattered throughout the city of Perth, Western Australia, few residents of Perth were aware of the role of these dark-coloured aircraft that operated only a few miles from the city centre. One commonly held belief was that they were heading off for missions to Papua New Guinea. And while such a misconception guaranteed the secrecy of the operation, for some, it had a negative side. Catalina crews were officially on the Royal Australian Air Force Reserve, but for security reasons they wore civilian clothes while off duty, a requirement for which First Officer Rex Senior suffered several unpleasant consequences. Once receiving a white feather neatly enclosed in an envelope. The Order of the White Feather was founded in Britain in August of 1914 as part of a strategy to encourage women to pressure their family and friends into enlisting. White feathers were given to young, fit men who did not volunteer for service. Many criticised the practice, arguing that, quote, idiotic young women were using white feathers to get rid of boyfriends of whom they'd grown tired, end quote. Services rendered badges were given to those who had been honourably discharged due to, you know, age, injury or illness to ensure that they were not accused of cowardice when they returned home. So unfortunately for First Officer Rex Senior, in his plain clothes, doing his secret air service for the Empire, most just assumed that he was a slacker who simply had not enlisted. On another occasion, while Rex Senior was walking one morning through King's Park on his way to work, he stopped at a kiosk to buy cigarettes, only to be told by the woman behind the counter, "Go and join up. There are no cigarettes for bludgers." It was not just in Australia he would have these run-ins with members of the public whilst on duty, albeit secret duty. At the other end of what would become the double sunrise route in Karachi, Rex Sr. would experience another incident which would baffle him for the rest of his life. Walking with one of his close friends, navigator Dolph Noosk, down a Karachi street, they were approached by a small Pakistani man who offered to tell their fortunes. For the equivalent of 10 shillings, the man produced what would turn out to be an almost textbook preview of Senior's life, but when Noosk held out his hand, the man handed back his money with the comment, "No tell, master." Within 2 years, Noosk was dead, killed when his aircraft disappeared over the Indian Ocean. With Singapore well and truly fallen into the hands of the Japanese by February of 1942, the air route between Australia and Britain was severed, preventing the rapid movement of VIP passengers and government mail between the two countries. In early 1943, the British and Australian governments agreed that British Overseas Airways Corporation, BOAC, would conduct an air service between Britain and Karachi, while the Australian airline Qantas would pioneer a new route from Ceylon, now Sri Lanka, to Australia using Catalina flying boats. These latter flights, which became famous as the double sunrise flights because crew and passengers often saw two sunrises during the 30 plus hours spent in the air, these were the longest commercial air services in the world at the time. Less well known is the Royal Australian Air Force support that made these flights possible. To avoid all areas controlled by Japanese forces, the route over the Indian Ocean was selected. As the Cocos Islands were within range of Japanese aircraft, they were considered unsuitable as a refueling stop. The original planning had the route going from the Exmouth Gulf, which is further north on the West Australian coast. Exmouth is actually the town I grew up in. They've got a Royal Australian Air Force base at Learmonth. They were planning on travelling from RAF Learmonth to the Royal Air Force base in Trincomalee, Ceylon, which was the shortest route and would have allowed the greatest payload to be carried. However, at the heavy weights that were necessary, takeoffs were only possible from smooth water. Remember, these are flying boats, Catalina seaplanes. So the route from the Swan River here in Perth, direct to Lake Koggala, Ceylon, was chosen. The distance was 22% longer than the next longest commercial air route, which was from Montreal, Canada, across the Atlantic Ocean to Scotland. Royal Australian Air Force Catalina aircraft were fully committed to flying bombing and reconnaissance missions against the Japanese at the time. However, Qantas had spare air crews that were experienced in pre-war flying boat operations on the route to Singapore. The British government made available Catalina aircraft, stripped, however, of defensive weapons, de-icing equipment, oxygen systems, and all cabin insulation that was unnecessary. This was all in order to save weight. To make the 8,789-kilometre journey, additional fuel tanks were fitted in the fuselage, so that with full tanks, a couple of passengers, and some mail, the aircraft's takeoff weight was 35,000 pounds, which is 6,000 pounds, or 2.7 tons, above its normal weight. The loss of a single engine, you know, anywhere in the first 10 hours of flight, would necessitate a forced landing in mid-ocean, with very little chance of rescue. The first of the double sunrise flights departed Perth on the 29th of June, 1943, flown by Captain Russell Tapp, an experienced Qantas flying boat captain, and our old mate, Senior First Officer Rex Senior. Rex had joined the Royal Australian Air Force in 1940 as a member of the First Empire Air Training Scheme Pilots Course. After an operational tour on Sunderland flying boats with the No. 10 Squadron in the UK, he was posted to No. 2 Air Navigation School in Victoria, where he qualified as an astro navigator. In early 1943, however, he volunteered for discharge so that he could take up a position on flying boats with Qantas. Qantas's only international route before the war was the little jump over the pond from Darwin to Singapore, which was largely flown in daylight hours following the island chains through the Dutch East Indies, you know, now Indonesia. The double sunrise route was quite different. To prevent interception by Japanese aircraft, the Qantas aircraft flew the entire mid-ocean part of the route at night, and operated the entire flight in radio silence. Navigating by the stars was the only practicable means of accurately guiding the aircraft under these conditions, but few Qantas crew members had these skills under their belt. However, many Royal Australian Air Force aircrew, experienced in long oceanic flights over the Atlantic or the Pacific, were ideal for the double sunrise service. On the first few flights, the co-pilots, such as Rex Senior, did the navigating. But within a few months, the Royal Australian Air Force seconded more than 8 navigators to Qantas, as well as a number of pilots experienced on flying boats. Now, despite being employed officially by Qantas, all crews on the double sunrise flights were members of the Royal Australian Air Force Reserve. They wore RAF flight suits over their Qantas uniforms. To fly an overwater air service of that length without accurate meteorological forecasts would have just been an absolute disaster. Forecasting for the air route from Perth to Ceylon was complicated by the fact that it stretched over 2 hemispheres and included both tropical and temperate regions, both with completely different weather patterns. To solve this, 3 Royal Australian Air Force meteorological officers, led by Squadron Leader John Hogan, maintained an around-the-clock meteorological service in Perth to provide the most accurate wind and weather forecasts that were possible at that time.
On that first flight, Captain Russell Tapp was the skipper. I was first officer. Glenn Mumford was radio operator, and Clark was the engineer. We departed Perth at around about 4 a.m. in the morning. We had about a 10-mile run from Nedlands to the bridge at Fremantle. And we'd start off with full power and the hull very low in the water. And as we managed to get up onto the step, we'd lift the wingtip floats to gain extra lift. And we'd often clear the bridge at Fremantle by no more than 100 feet or so. I often used to think that people at Fremantle must have wondered when we were going to hit them. I think we were all so keyed up that I don't think any of us took much time off. We were aware that we were doing something that had never been done before, and it was very exciting, and I don't recall any time off on that trip. We sighted Lake Koggala and Russell landed us on the water, and we taxied over to the Air Force base to be met by the Air Force personnel and congratulated on the fact that we'd actually managed to do what the aviation authorities in Australia had considered to be impossible. The feeling of, the feeling of success, we'd done it.
When Qantas obtained B-24 Liberators for the Australia to Ceylon service, the days of the double sunrise flights were numbered. These were the first planes to come bearing a kangaroo emblem on the nose. The Liberators gradually began to supersede the Catalinas. These faster, more comfortable Liberator ships could do this crossing in 10 hours less than the Catalinas and carry over four times more the payload. So on the 17th of July, 1945, the last Catalina service took off from Lake Koggala for Perth. After making 271 crossings of the Indian Ocean without a single loss, the era of the double sunrise flights had come to a close. The double sunrise cruise had carried 648 passengers, 18 tons of mail and priority cargo in defiance of the Japanese attempts to blockade Australia. The experience gained by Qantas in the double sunrise flights allowed the company to restart the major air routes that linked Australia with the world immediately after the war. This included pioneering the Pacific route to Hawaii and San Francisco. By combining the strengths and resources of the Royal Australian Air Force and a commercial airline, a vital air service was established and maintained. It was a great example of an air force supporting an airline to carry out a strategically important task during a critically important wartime operation. Soon after the final double sunrise flights had flown, the Nedlands base was closed, and the Western Operation Division headquarters was moved inland to Guildford. There would, however, be some lasting mementos of this unique service. Every passenger carried on the service received a coloured certificate denoting their membership of, quote, the secret order of the double sunrise, for experiencing the sunrise twice during your more than 24-hour flight. Somewhat fittingly, and just by chance, Hudson Fysh, the man who had done most to carry the fight for the establishment of this service, became the holder of the double sunrise certificate for the longest of the Catalina flights, from Ceylon to Perth in 31 hours and 15 minutes. On his way back from talks in London. Even after the war, American airmen found it hard to believe what the Qantas Catalinas had achieved, considering their own 2,500-mile, 4,000-kilometre stretch between California and Honolulu, the ultimate challenge. Amateurs, mate. Even with the coming of the jet age, the Indian Ocean Service stands as an incredible accomplishment, particularly when pitted against the extremely strict guidelines surrounding the operation of twin-engine aircraft over water, guidelines which existed well into the jet age. Fish would describe the Indian Ocean Service as, quote, the most fascinating and romantic undertaking ever performed by Qantas, end quote. Other aviation accolades would follow when the veil of secrecy was lifted after the war. Although Fish himself would repeatedly fail in his efforts to gain for them official recognition, despite pointing out that the crews faced the same risks flying through enemy skies as any of their military counterparts. Had they been shot down and captured, they would have suffered the exact same fate as any soldier or pilot. Frustrated, Hudson Fish created his own special company award, the Long Range Operations Gold Star, which would later become known as the Crowther Cross, to be worn on the uniforms of those who took part. As for their faithful Catalinas that carried these pilots, sadly, they were destined for a watery grave. Due to the terms of Lend-Lease, under which any World War II aircraft emanating from the United States or anywhere else outside the country were forbidden from having any impact on the economy of the country to which they had been loaned at the end of hostilities. Basically, what all that means is we're not going to let, like, America send a bunch of planes over here for use during the war, but then when the war ends, suddenly they're here and they start up their own airline and just cut our, you know, homegrown business out. So we'd made laws to stop that happening. The four aircraft that we still had in Perth were flown out to sea near Rottnest Island in November of 1945, set with explosive charges and scuttled. Ironically, though, as if defying fate to the end, one Catalina, Rigel Star, refused to submit to the explosive charges and just wouldn't sink, forcing those charged with dispatching her to fire over 500 rounds of 303 bullets before she finally caught a light and disappeared beneath the waves just outside of Rotto. The fifth Catalina, Spicker Star, which was then at Rose Bay, so she wasn't in Perth with the other four when they got sunk. She was actually sunk off Sydney 3 months later. As for the men who flew and serviced these stellar planes, many would go on to accomplish careers in Qantas and other areas of Australian aviation. That was just the mentality in those days, with that war thing done and dusted. Everyone went back to work.
At the tender age of 48, 6 months after his last performance in Sydney. Peter did leave behind one of the most poignant songs ever written about Australia. I still call Australia home. Peter Allen, Mist, and truly, the boy from Oz.
I've been to cities that never close down.
Sons and daughters spinning around.
straight.